Good morning. We are so glad to have you in worship with us this morning, and I have just a few announcements for you. Today, we observe All Saints, and after the service, if you would still like to add names to our tablecloth, you are more than welcome to do so, and we hope that you will. Today is the last day to make elder nominations. Nomination forms are located out the doors in the narthex. You could ask one of the guys out there and they will direct you to those forms. Those that are nominated and elected would be serving as an elder for a 3-year term beginning in January. You must be a member to nominate someone, and the person nominated must be a member as well. We hope you'll take a moment and do that today, as, like I said, it's our last day for that. This evening at 6 o'clock in the fellowship hall, we will be having a Safe Sanctuaries training meeting. And this is for anyone who is a volunteer that volunteers with our youth or children. So come be a part of it. We need you there and to get you all fixed up to keep serving in that way. If you can't be here tonight, please let me know and I will get you situated the best way that I can. If you are singing in this year's choir cantata, the schedule is on the back of your bulletin on the Sundays that are, I believe it's tonight at 5 o'clock. So and you can see the rest of those dates for practice. So we hope that you'll come and be a part of that. We are going to be holding a pastor's class for elementary school age children who want to know more about Jesus and who want to know more about what it means to put our faith in him and be a member, a part of this church in particular. And so they are going to be meeting on November 10th and November 17th during the Sunday school hour. If you need some more information about that, see Pastor Michael. If we have any youth members here, they will be having their Thanksgiving gathering next Sunday evening, November 10th at 4:30 in the fellowship hall for their Thanksgiving meal. If you want to come, please RSVP to Dan for that so we make sure we have enough food, and families are invited to be a part of that as well. We will also be having a membership class on December 1st. This is for any youth and adults who would like to find out more about this church and our theology and what we believe and becoming a member. It will be in the evening and we will have dinner for you. So we hope that you'll come and be a part of that. All right, I think that's all of my announcements, Steve. Oh, wait, I do have one more. We are having new church t-shirts available to you. Leanne and I have been working on a design, and we finally got all of those plans and prices and all of that. If you would like to order a t-shirt, you'll have to go to our website, winchestercp.org, and there is a link to the t-shirt form. And so you can go on there and fill out what you want. There are 3 choices on colors for adults and 3 different choices for our kids. But you go and you fill out that form and I will get that. You can pay online or you can pay by cash or check. Just bring it here to church. But we're looking forward to having some new church shirts that we can wear around town. So we hope that you will get one of those.
Good morning. Would you please stand as we share together Holy Ground? It's number 138. Please stand.
We are standing on holy ground, and I know that there are angels all around. Let us praise Jesus now. We are standing in his presence on holy ground.
Beautiful music, good way to start our morning. Please turn. Tell someone hello. Give them a hug.
morning. Let's sing it one more time. We are standing on holy ground, and I know that there are angels all around. Let us praise Jesus now. On holy ground.
Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship. Fling wide the temple gates, open the ancient doors. The mighty and glorious one is coming.
Who is?
This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in God. And now the invocation. God of all glory, we gather here today with the saints of every time and place to honor and praise your holy name. You have revealed your mercy and might your faithful people in every age. So let us glimpse, even through our tears, the mystery of your life-giving grace and the love that even death cannot destroy. Through Jesus Christ, Alpha and Omega. Amen.
Our hymn this morning is based on Hebrews 13:16. Do not forget to do good and to share with others. Let us enjoy together, Glorious is Thy Name, Most Holy, 677.
Glorious is Thy Name, Most Holy, God and Father of us all. Servants bow before thee, strive to answer every call. The
You may be seated.
Hear our call to confession. Jesus, our great high priest, calls us to confess our sins, to receive forgiveness, and to be renewed for lives of freedom and joy. Join me in the prayer of confession. God, giver of all good things, we have failed to live in thanksgiving for earth, our families, neighbors, and strangers, for the air we breathe, the water we drink, and the soil that grows our food. Forgive us for our sins against you, your creation, our neighbors, through disobedience to your will in word and deed, and be happy in your steadfast love. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Lord. Amen. Beloved, the Lord is loving, merciful, and just. Therefore, we are reconciled to God and to one another, so that we might walk in peace and love. Thanks be to God.
Oh, for a thousand.
Thank you, Tammy. I have a few prayer concerns I'd like to lift before you this morning. We want to continue to keep in our prayers Wayne Hill, who is still in Chattanooga. Tom McGill is going to be having his other knee replaced tomorrow, so please keep him and Helen in your prayers. Dwayne Benson is recovering from a recent knee replacement as well. We always want to remember those that are dealing with cancer. Kevin Seiler, Mike Cunningham, Eddie Winger, Bob Adelman, Teresa Peacock, Carrie Birch, Easton Taylor, Dan Birchfield, Jennifer Taylor, Sue Watson, Jordan Butcher, Meadow Cupkey, Betty Jacobs, Vicki Hill, Cassie Sharber, and we add one more to this list this morning, Brad Whitmire, so please keep them in your prayers. We also want to, as always, continue to pray for those that don't know Jesus, that don't have a church home, and we just pray that somehow we can reach out to them, for them to be a part of this church family. And as always, we want to remember those that are still dealing with the effects of the flooding in western North Carolina and East Tennessee, and all those that have lost loved ones in that as well. It's going to be a long recovery for them, so we just keep on praying for them. Are there any others that we need to lift up this morning? Then let's go to God in prayer. O Lord, our God, we thank you for the many people who have followed your way of life joyfully, for the many saints and martyrs, men and women who have offered up their very lives so that your life abundant may become manifest and your kingdom may advance. They chose the way of your Son, Jesus Christ, and in the midst of trial, they held out hope. In the midst of persecutions, they witnessed to your power. And in the midst of despair, they clung to your promise. O Lord, we thank you for the truth that they have learned and passed on to us. Give us courage to follow their way of life. For your love and faithfulness, we will at all times praise your name. We pray for the millions in our world who must go hungry today, all who are exploited and marginalized because of their caste or class, color or sex, that they may not lose their hope and may find the strength to struggle for their dignity. We call upon you for those who are persecuted, imprisoned, tortured, or threatened with death because of their witness to justice and peace, for those who have disappeared because they dared to speak, that their spirits may not be broken by their body's pain. We remember those who live in regions torn by tension and war, by disaster, famine, and poverty. And we pray for the millions of refugees around the world, that in the midst of tears and bitterness, they may discern signs of hope. Lord, into your hands we commend our earth, ever threatened with disaster, and all persons and situations we have spoken about this morning, written down or remembered in the silence of our hearts this day. Strengthen our will for peace and justice. Increase our faith in your kingdom, where love and faithfulness will meet. Righteousness and peace will embrace, and may your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name we pray, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture today comes to us from the Gospel of Matthew in the first chapter, verses 1 through 17. And I hope that you'll bear with me because there are a lot of names. And there's a lot of names that I'm not really sure I know how to pronounce, but I'm going to try to be convincing to you this morning. So bear with me. This is the genealogy of Jesus, the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac, Isaac the father of Jacob, Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers. Judah the father of Perez and Zerah, whose mother was Tamar. Perez, the father of Hezron. Hezron, the father of Ram. Ram, the father of Amminadab. Amminadab, the father of Nahshon. Nahshon, the father of Salmon. Salmon, the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab. Boaz, the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth. Obed, the father of Jesse. And Jesse, the father of King David. David was the father of Solomon, whose mother had been Uriah's wife. Solomon, the father of Rehoboam. Rehoboam, the father of Abijah. Abijah, the father of Asa. Asa, the father of Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat, the father of Jehoram. Jehoram, the father of Uzziah. Uzziah, the father of Jotham. Jotham, the father of Ahaz. Ahaz, the father of Hezekiah. Hezekiah, the father of Manasseh. Manasseh, the father of Amon. Amon, the father of Josiah. And Josiah, the father of, I'm not sure about this one, Jeconiah and his brother at the time of the exile to Babylon. And after the exile to Babylon, Jeconiah was the father of Shealtiel, the father of Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel, the father of Abihud. Abihud, the father of Eliakim. Eliakim, the father of Azor. Azor, the father of Zadok. Zadok, the father of Achim. Achim, the father of Elihud. Elihud, the father of Eleazar. Eleazar, the father of Mathan. Mathan, the father of Jacob. And Jacob, the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary. And Mary was the mother of Jesus, who is called the Messiah. Thus, there were 14 generations in all, from Abraham to David, 14 from David to the exile to Babylon, and 14 from the exile to the Messiah. Friends, this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So, for many people, and me included, reading that Bible passage just now can be the stuff of nightmares. Because we don't know how to say all of these names. Many of us don't like to get up and talk in front of people, period, right? And then to have to read all of these names, and sometimes there's places that we don't know how to pronounce in our biblical passages. And so all of these, if I asked one of y'all to come and read today's scriptures, y'all might have had a heart attack this morning. That would have been really, it's a lot. There's a lot of names, and I practiced it a few times, but as you can see, it's still, those names can be tricky. And so I think when we get to some of these genealogies, there's many genealogies in the Bible, and when we get to them, I don't know about you, but a lot of times I skip over them. If I'm reading through, because I'm like, it's just a bunch of names. Like, it's not that important. It's not that big of a deal. And it takes a long time to read, and I don't know how to pronounce the name. So I'm gonna go on to the next part, the action that's actually happening. And I began to think about it. And I think if you thought about it a little bit too, we would probably come to the agreement that it's not just a long list of names. Today, as a church, we are remembering names. We have a tablecloth here in front of us this morning that has been filled with names. My guess is there's probably names on there I can't pronounce too. But I know with all of my heart that each and every one of these names here this morning has a story and has someone who loves them, that remembers them. And so these names are not meaningless names, are they? And the names that we find in our scriptures, even in the genealogies, they're not meaningless names either. Jen Wilkins says that in the genealogies, God speaks to us of his attention to the individual. He sees us not as a teeming mass of humanity, but as individual names and faces and personalities, each with our own stories that play into the larger story of redemption. In the genealogies, God attests to his faithfulness to do what he says he will do, working through heroes and hucksters, all far from perfect. No plan of his can be thwarted. Each name is a blade of withered grass, but his eternal purposes endure. She continues, every name points to our need of the one who bears the name above all names. Every name recorded and remembered by God gives us assurance that our names are recorded and remembered by him as well. So this month, we are going to be focusing on four names that are found in Jesus's genealogy. So if you're like me and you tend to skip over the genealogies, you may not have noticed anything odd about the genealogy that's found in Matthew's gospel. But I want to share with you this morning a few things. In a strict patriarchal society, in all of the other genealogies that we find from this time period, it's made up of men's names, and only men's names, because the lineage was traced through the male line. But in Matthew's genealogy here, in Jesus' genealogy, we get four women named. And if you weren't careful, you missed the last one, because it mentions her husband and not her, but it's referring to her. And if that's not enough to make you a little bit curious about who these women were and why they're listed in Jesus' genealogy, you know, I think about what happened in their lives. Who are they? What did they do? But what if I told you that each of these four women mentioned are in some way a part of a scandal, and yet they are listed here in this most important genealogy, right along with heroes of our faith? So I want to lay all the cards on the table this morning. The story you are about to hear is a very awkward story. You will not hear many sermons about this scripture passage that I'm about to tell you this morning. If you go and search, there are not many. Most people avoid it because the subject matter is one that is uncomfortable for us to read about and to talk about and to hear about. And as I was preparing for this sermon, I asked myself many a time why I had gotten myself into this. But I will tell you that I've learned a lot from this scripture passage, and I hope that you will too. So the first woman to be mentioned in Jesus' genealogy is Tamar. There are two Tamars in the Bible. One here in Genesis 38, which is the one we're going to be talking about today. And then there's another one in, I think it's in Kings, or it's in, I'd have to look it up. It's along, she's one of David's daughters. So there's two, and neither one of them have a good story. So nobody go and name their children or daughter Tamar. You don't want to do that. And it's interesting because we find Tamar's story smack dab in the middle of Joseph's story. And it seems really odd because up until this time, we have heard about Joseph and his brothers and them getting mad about the dreams that he had and, you know, deciding to kill him. And then they decide, no, we're just going to sell him into slavery. And then they sell him, and you have this one chapter right there in the middle of Judah and Tamar. And then as soon as it's over, the action picks back up with Joseph in Egypt. And so it seems really odd that you would have this story. But as I was reading and studying and thinking, I think this chapter helps us to refocus on who the most important character in this story really is. See, the story that we get really isn't about Joseph. It's really about Judah. Judah will be the brother that the promised Messiah will come from, not Joseph. And so, while it's a quick, ugly story, I think it helps us to kind of shift and remember that this story is really about Judah. Now, you have to know Joseph's story. And you have to see where Joseph ends up and his interactions with Judah to kind of understand the whole picture. All right, so on to the story. So after Joseph has been sold into slavery, Judah, who was instrumental in selling Joseph, he was kind of the instigator of all of this, heads off on his own. He goes away from his family, and he goes and he marries a Canaanite woman. And he has three sons with her. He has Onan, and Selah. The children grow up, and is married to a Canaanite woman named Tamar. Long story short, is a wicked man, and God kills him. And in their culture, when that eldest son was killed or died, the next son, if he was unmarried, would marry the wife so that she could have children, so that they could inherit the firstborn's double portion of blessing and inheritance that would be passed down. So, Judah is trying to do the right thing, and he marries Tamar to Onan, the second son. Now, Onan does not want to have any children with Tamar because he wants to inherit the firstborn's portion himself. And so, he secretly prevents Tamar from conceiving. And this action is wicked in God's eyes as well. And so, God puts Onan to death too. So Judah does not want to marry his third son, Selah, to Tamar. He believes she's kind of something like a black widow at this point in time. And so he tells her, okay, I promise when Selah's old enough, I'll marry you to him. But in the meantime, you're going to go back and live with your father's family. Well, this was a disrespectful way to deal with Tamar. She would have had no income. She would have had no chance to remarry anyone else in this situation. And so Tamar progressively becomes more and more victimized by this family as time goes on. She has been married to two wicked men, and then she's left with nothing. And she finds herself in a desperate place in her father's house. So Tamar takes matters into her own hands. Tamar knows that Judah's wife has died and that he has been in the habit of paying women to sleep with him. And so she takes off her widow's clothes and puts on a pretty dress, and she covers her face and she sets herself to come into contact with Judah. And Judah takes her up on it, never realizing who she is. He promises her payment in the form of a goat, but he doesn't have a goat with him. And so she says, hey, you need to leave something with me so that, you know, I make sure you're going to come back and pay me. And so he leaves his signet, his cord, and his staff. And it's kind of like us leaving our wallet, our keys, and our driver's license with someone. So Tamar gets pregnant from this interaction. And eventually Judah hears that she's pregnant. And he, in their society, since he kind of really, she belongs to his family, he has the right to pronounce judgment on Tamar. And he says she should be burned. She is pregnant and she should be burned. But see, she still has his wallet and his keys and his driver's license. And so Tamar pulls out her trump cards and reveals herself to Judah. And Judah realizes he has messed up. And he proclaims that Tamar is more righteous than he. And eventually she will deliver twin boys. And it's through her son Perez that Jesus' line continues. Now, you may be like me. And even Steve came to me this week and said, what in the world kind of soap opera did I just read? And you would be right. It's a soap opera. But for me, the bigger question is, how is this woman considered righteous after all of the things that she did? And why is she included in Jesus's genealogy? So we're going to have to travel back to the Garden of Eden for just a minute to understand what's going on here. After Adam and Eve were deceived by the serpent in the garden, if you remember the story, God comes and speaks to them. You know, they're hiding, and God calls out to them and says, you know, where are you? Come, and they have this whole conversation. And in the wake of this great disaster, God says a couple of things to Adam and Eve and the serpent. One, God curses the serpent to above all animals and says that he shall go on his belly and eat dust the rest of his life. And the second one is that he promises that there will be enmity between the serpent and the woman. While she was initially drawn to his lies, she has learned her lesson and will now wage war against him for the purposes of delivering the one who will eventually crush the serpent's head for good, forever. And so throughout the rest of the Old Testament, we get stories of women doing just that. And Tamar is the first of these stories and these women. Tamar, throughout our church history, has been somewhat labeled as a lying prostitute. But I don't believe she is either one of those things. In her story, Judah has stepped into the role of the serpent. He has fallen so deep into sin that he has become the one that comes to kill, steal, and destroy. Judah eventually finds redemption in the story, thank God. But not in this particular instance of his story. Tamar and the other women in the Old Testament, they wage war against sin. They all say, no, not on our watch. These women use the serpent's own tools of deception against him. Tamar becomes a strong deliverer by using the tools that she has against the one who has withheld what was rightfully hers. Women in the Bible are usually the underdogs in a society that gave them no power of their own and no agency, no choice. So she resorts to using the weapons that she has available to her to contend for what is right. And she secures the rights of the firstborn for her children. We look at this story and it's really hard to fathom. And we judge her from a 21st century view for her actions. And it's easy because we don't understand the culture that she lived in. But Judah himself says, she is more righteous than I. And this, it got me thinking about people who have done things, maybe not so good things, in the name of God and promise and the future and the gospel. And I was thinking about people who, you know, helped with the Underground Railroad. The Underground Railroad was a form of resistance to enslavement leading up to and through the end of the Civil War. People used escape and flight to escape slavery. And it was a collaborative effort by enslaved people, by free blacks, Native Americans, and many people from different religious and ethnic groups. And these people used any means necessary to help these enslaved people. They used disguises. They forged documents. They had secret codes and pathways and many other strategies that they used so that these people would not be caught and so that they could reach freedom. I think about the thousands and thousands of people who risked their lives during World War II, who hid Jews, who helped downed fighter pilots to get out of occupied Europe, to the many people who fought in resistance movements against Hitler. People were very creative in finding ways to save lives. They falsified documents, they forged documents, they lied, they cheated, they stole so that others could have a chance at life. We don't call these people thieves or liars Many of them have been celebrated as heroes. Evil had come to steal, kill, and destroy, and these people said no, and they tried to do whatever they could to save life. And they joined a rich history of biblical women who, in extreme circumstances, valued life more than the rules. And I don't know about you, but there is this huge tension for me in this story. I don't know. Using deception, you know, all the things that we've told are wrong. How can it be right in this moment? And I don't know that I have an answer for you this morning on what I think about that. This story still has so much in it to me that I would like to think about and pray about. And I didn't have time, and I wish I did. Wilkins says that Tamar does what underdogs do. She resorts to using the weapons available to her to contend for what is right, and she acts over against the established order to further God's promises. And through Tamar, the line would continue. The line that would one day lead to Jesus thrives. One commentator said that Jesus' lineage does not float above the maelstrom of life. God works in and through what appears weak and despised. And yes, her actions would normally be offensive to us. These are actions that cannot and should not be universalized. But her actions are righteous here because they do justice to the relationship that she was in with Judah, and they save the line of promise. I think this brings up that, you know, this age-old question that we have dealt with of, do the means justify the ends? Do Tamar's intentions justify her actions? And it seems to me that in this instance, God says, yes, it does. And I'm not sure how to resolve that tension. But I do know that the church has to step into the role, and the church has stepped into the role of fighting against the serpent. All we have to do is look around or see the news to know that the church is the underdog in our culture. And so we are charged to take up the fight. We have to say no, not on our watch, to the evil that Satan has unleashed on this world. We become the quiet subversives, and we have to figure out ways to exist and fight in this world that we live in. So did you know that when you joined and became a Christian, you joined a rebel movement? Probably not. You probably didn't think of it that way. But following Jesus is and should be countercultural in every way. But we are countercultural for the beauty of the gospel. We are subversive because we are putting the gospel forward, and in every step we take, we are fighting for all to have life and have a quality of life that Jesus would want all to have. And we guard the inheritance that has been passed down to us, just as Tamar did. And as I was thinking about this, a modern day example, in Memphis, when I was there in seminary, there was a group called Manna House, and they helped the homeless. They became a place where the homeless could come and get showers and food and wash their clothes a couple of times a week. It was a safe place for them to be. And as they learned the needs and what was really happening in these people's lives, they would try to get them help. But one of the obstacles that they came up against was that to get some kinds of help, you have to have a license or a photo ID, an official state form of identification. Well, you can't have an official form of identification unless you have an address. So they would lie and say that these people lived at the Manna House address so that they could get their identification, so that they could get help. Do we call them liars? I don't. They're helping people live. It's like I said, there's so much tension for me with this story and where it goes. And I'm still struggling with it. And I'm going to continue to think about it. And I hope you will too. Throughout the rest of this month, we are going to be looking at the three other women who stood up to evil in their own ways. Rahab, Ruth, and Bathsheba. They joined Tamar in the list of names that means that we have a Savior. That means that the serpent will be crushed forever one day. I hope that you will join with me to choose this beautiful gospel and by joining in the fight and joining these four women. Would you pray with me? God, we thank you for this day and for bringing us here. God, we struggle with some of the things that are brought up in the scripture passage. It's not an easy one. It's a hard one. And God, we just pray that we can join you in the fight against evil. Help us to do the right thing in the right ways. And this scripture brings up so much tension and so many questions. But Lord, I pray that we will forever keep the gospel in mind and remember that Jesus didn't follow the rules either when it meant that someone could have life and have it abundantly. God, we love you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
This morning, I want to welcome you to this table. Not because it is itself special, but because it is an echo of another table. A table that stretches as far as the eye can see. A table that is laden with God's good gifts. A table where no one goes hungry or sits alone. A table where everyone we ever loved and whoever loved
As we end our service together, let us share, "Oh Jesus, I Have Promised," 676. We'll sing the first and last verses. Please stand.
Jesus, I have promised to love thee to the end. Be thou forever near me, my master and my friend. I shall not fear the battle if thou art by my side. No from the pathway, if thou would be my guide. Oh Jesus, thou hast promised to all who follow thee that where thou art in glory, there shall thy servant be. And Jesus, I have promised to serve thee to the end. Oh, give me grace to follow my master and my friend.
Please be seated.
Hear our call to give. Our God is ever faithful and provides everything that we need. Let us praise the Lord through our giving so that our offerings may be acceptable to God. Please rise for the benediction. May the Lord our God, the Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end, be with you this day and forevermore. We hope that you leave renewed in your desire to know God, to love God, and to show God, so that others may come to know God as well. Have a blessed week.
Our musical response is "When the Roll is Caught Up Yonder." We'll sing the first verse, and I chose this morning because we all have lost a loved ones, and many of our church family names and friends and neighbors are on our cloth down here. So I thought it would be very appropriate, because one day we're going to be with them in heaven. Let's sing "When the Roll Is Called Up Yonder."
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal, bright and fair, when the saved on earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder.